Okay, well, welcome back to lunch. During the second portion of our training for today, we're going to be going over something I call the Day in Life module. It is going to cover what a day in the life of a low voltage technician on a typical day is going to look like, and how we're going to be successful at that day and some of the tips. Now, some of these things you've seen already in the field during the course of this week, and you recognize them as best practices and things to do. Other things you have no idea why I'm doing them, or may have even not noticed that I'm doing them. But now we're going to expose some of those things. So, any questions before we start? Okay, this is a very interactive portion. Let me know if you have questions. Tampering, we're going to cover projects, are going to be a separate thing. Issues and perception, we'll end up going over, and there will be a portion of this also role play. So, when does a day in the life start? Starts the night before. Okay? Things that we can do to make sure we're successful the night before an appointment are routing, checking your maps, checking your distance, checking your weather, not forgetting to check for traffic. Diego, if you check your appointment here in Schaumburg at midnight, what's Google Maps going to tell you? As far as right, and when you check it at 8 a.m., what's it going to tell you?
2.5 hours to 45.
Right, so make sure you're taking some of that traffic data, historical traffic data, into consideration when you're plotting your time. Now, that becomes inherently harder when you're out of town and you don't know if it's a main road or not. So, you know, make sure you're checking the traffic at peak hours, leaving yourself enough time. Of course, we talked about all week how we want to be on site 15 minutes early. We want to make sure that we're face-to-face with the POC by the appointment time. Very often, when you meet the POC is significantly after you arrive on site. And we ran into that a couple times this week. Oh, we're here. Okay, let me go get this guy. Oh, he's on vacation. Let me get this guy. Let me get that guy. And we can lose 15 minutes there pretty quickly. What else can we do the night before, though, to prep? I don't want to get into the POC interaction just yet. You can preload your work orders. It's not a mandatory step. It doesn't save you a ton of time, but it does save you time. Let's talk tooling.
Do you have your tool bags in order? Everything is critical that you don't just have a phone in there so that you're not always searching while you're doing your job.
Okay. Drill batteries. Headlamp batteries. Phone batteries. Everything should be charged full when you leave the house. Okay, now we're also going to be equipping you with PPE. Does anybody know what PPE is? Personal protective equipment. Hard hat, safety goggles, high visibility vest. Steel toes are your own requirement. I picked up a set of steel-toed sneakers for $35 that were black, gray, and yellow. Happened to be the company colors. Those out of Red Wing, I believe. And they were not special order size 13, so they're pretty well equipped over there. But you do need to have some steel toes, and we'll talk about how that works out on site a little bit later. What else can we do to prepare?
Get a good night's rest.
Get a good night's rest, absolutely. Make good decisions about when you should go to bed. Make good decisions about what you should do instead of going to bed if you are not going to bed. Outfit. Clothing, preparedness. We may be working outside. It might be raining. It might be cold. It might be colder than you think. It might be hotter than you think. You know, I like to carry a ton of clothes with me in the car. Over the years, you know, the colder it gets, you just keep throwing on layers here in Chicago. I keep a pair of shorts in the car in the winter, but now you can't wear shorts on every job site. And I will get into explaining a little bit of that difference. So these are some of the things you can do the night before to get ready and make sure that you're set up for success in the morning. Get gas the night before is a big one. I can tell you a story about when I left my home in Elk Grove and was headed to an appointment up in Elkhart, Wisconsin. First gas station I passed was packed. So now I want to do that. Got 10 bucks, there's 20 cars in there, keep rolling, I'll pass 100 gas stations on the way. Second, third gas station, packed, 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 gas prices are still high. I'll wait a little bit out of Cook County. I got out of Cook County, went to the first gas station, power was out. Went to the second gas station, power was out. Third, fourth, fifth, sixth, they were all powered out the whole drive. Ended up running out of gas and coasting into a gas station that also had power out. Sat there for about 15 minutes before the power came back on. And then, after the power came on, I waited there another 2 hours to figure out how to turn the gas back on. Yep. And I was 2 hours late to the appointment because I didn't get gas in my car. You know, some of these things are uncontrollable, but I could have avoided it even though I couldn't control it. So, there's another thing you can do. When you arrive on site, keep in mind you are now on somebody's business property. Somebody owns the business, somebody puts their heart and soul into these businesses, and you are now on their property. Don't assume you can park anywhere. You know, be respectful when you're on site. Don't pull in with your sound system banging. Don't pull in speeding, do burnouts on gravel or anything like that. We are there representing a client who's a multi-million-dollar company, as pretty much every one of our clients are. And, that's something that'll get reported right away. Make sure you get to your POC by the appointment time. Now we get to the point where we're going to start discussing POC interaction. Where's the other marker? There's a technique that I like to use when dealing with points of contact. You've seen it at least once or twice this week if you were paying attention or if you noticed it as a specific technique. We're going to do two different interactions. Okay? I really want to get Glenn in here for this. Let me pause for that. Glenn, are you available? Can you come in for the role play?
Sure.
You're going to be the PLC, and I'm going to approach you in two different ways. Okay. Can you?
You can have one.
Sure.
Awesome. This is other life.
All right.
You want to come over here? Come on. All right. For this portion of the training,
my lovely assistant.
It's going to be Glenn Romeo, our National Service Manager. So Glenn's going to be playing the part of the point of contact, right?
So.
Hi, PLC. I'm Martin Novak. I'm here representing Climatics.
All right. Hi. We have a couple of GPSs to install today, but it was where I parked, okay?
Where are you late?
I'm on time. Couple.
You're late for me. I've been waiting here an hour for you guys to show up, and now you're going to show up and you're talking about you want to install some stuff?
Oh, my apologies. I must be so confused in the calendar. I can check with dispatch.
Yeah, you need to call your company. I'm not happy.
Okay. Well, because we're late, is there a specific vehicle you want me to do first?
We got those five over there.
Okay. Let me get right on that. You're not.
Okay. I'm sorry. Just want to prepare you.
That can happen.
Yeah. All right. Sorry.
Okay.
So how will we dissolve that situation?
Well, if we're late in his eyes, what does he need done first? Okay, you think we're late? There's no point in me arguing that. The guy thinks we're late. He's the one who's writing checks to somebody. He's writing the checks to us. Okay, fine, we're late then. It's not going to change how I go home and go to bed, right? Whether I prove my point or don't prove my point, I don't know. Maybe our dispatch had it wrong. Maybe our ticket was wrong for the client. Maybe we're not even at the right address. But if he really thinks we're late, then we're late. And what do you want done first? How can I stop the bleeding on the situation? You know? This comes back to a point that I was going to mention a little bit later called issues and perceptions. Okay? The perception here is that there's an issue. And that issue is directly related to our company, which is low voltage. Okay? It's not about who's right or wrong. It's about the fact that there is an issue and that the word issue is going to be attached to low voltage. If it turns out that he's wrong and the appointment was right based on everything we have, it doesn't matter. He still has a perceptive issue with our company and our timeliness, attendance, punctuality.
This goes with the customer's always right.
Yes. It does kind of get into that. But in this case,
It's also the client's obligation too. You know, if he goes and complains to Mixed Telematics, and Mixed Telematics looks at the order and says, oh, well, he was right. There are still emails within Mixed Telematics that have the word issue and the words low voltage paired together. Okay? And that's what people are going to walk away from that with. It's not whether or not you're right or wrong. It's whether or not it's an issue at all. And that comes into something that I get a little deeper into later called 1-0-1. Okay? In this situation, we're already at negative. Let's just try and get back to zero. I'm not going to ask this POC for a letter of recommendation. I'm not going to try and sell him some additional products, right? I'm not going to shoot this off the weather. I'm just going to get to work, get it done, and try and get the situation back to a zero. When we have the word issue attached to anything that you do, even if you're not in the wrong, it's an issue and it's perceived negatively. That's it. If we have 5 issues that aren't our fault, and then 1 that's our fault, they've still dealt with us 6 times. See where I'm going with? So these are some of the grand scheme things that I go over in this training. Now, for this example, I'm going to put you in 2 different manners. As a somewhat arrogant technician, and the technician is going to be demonstrating a dominance by recessiveness. Okay? So let's do the arrogant tech first. Okay, walk in. Hey, PLC. You're Tom?
Yep.
I'm here to do 4 GPSs. You got the equipment?
Yeah.
Okay. Where is it? I'm going to get to work. I got some other appointments.
This is the box of the bagger shop.
Okay, well, let's go back there, blah, blah, blah. Okay? That's horrible. Now, what if that POC doesn't like where I park? Based on the way I interact with him, he can now make that an issue with us. Okay, and say, well, you know, hey, parked over there, that's Tammy's spot. And, you know, I don't like you now. This guy just comes in here, parking wherever he wants. I'm giving him things to complain about. Okay, I've allowed the ability to go negative and the ability to put issues with our name. Now, if I come in this way,
Hey, Tom.
Mark, here representing Fleematics. We have
4 trucks to do today.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
I parked over there. I don't know if that's an acceptable place to park.
Actually, if you can move to the next space over, because we've got a shipment coming in, we've got to get that spot.
Yeah.
Okay. Do you want to do the equipment and get plans, and then I move right in?
If you move it now, that'd be
okay. I'm going to move it.
Move it. Come back. Okay.
What I've done is I've taken away the ability for the PLC to complain about where we parked.
Now I'm going to ask him what he wants on. I'm going to take away the ability to complain about the order in which we did the trucks. If we have something to mount in the truck, we're going to talk about where that mounting is. So I've taken away the ability for the point of contact to complain about where we mounted it. And I'm dominating the situation by being the recessive person in the conversation. And that's a lot of our POC interactions go, and that's how you're going to win a lot of these POCs. What's up, Lakeisha? Okay. Joe. Knee deep. I can roll without you if you want to touch Bernard or Joe.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
So this dominance by recessive is a big part of how I interact with the POCs while on site.
You take away their ability to complain. Okay?
We went to a 2 Fleematics swaps. That was actually 2 Fleematics repair. I remember afterwards we went to that McDonald's.
Yeah.
Anybody catch that interaction I had with the POC when he asked me to
move my car?
No. I walked away from some nice people.
A POC came in hot. Hey, I don't know which one of you guys has that car parked there on the end, but you can't do that. I got deliveries coming in. I got this and that. You just can't do that.
What I say, I could.
Not a problem. Where would you like me to move it? I don't know where to move it on the street somewhere. It just can't be over there.
Not a problem. Thanks.
I'll move right out.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. He didn't have to come at me like that.
You know?
And somebody without... trying not to self-compliment here, somebody without the resolve or the level mind, or maybe somebody that's been getting, just having themselves hit, you know, getting killed in a vehicle, having problem after problem after problem, and now it's 5:00, and you're supposed to be done at 4, and your girl's calling you, hey, what's up with dinner, and then you're trying to verify, and it keeps hanging up,
slow cell signal, and you're getting self-aggravated, you lost a tool, you broke a pick, you cut your finger, whatever it is, and then this guy comes at you, it can easily be the trigger to lose your cool. And you gotta play it like that. So yeah, you want me to park there? Not a problem. I have a situation, and it was a Little Rock. We were Little Rock, Arkansas. We were doing cable one with the cable company. We were the first ones on site. I pulled up and parked on the first spot. It's a gravel park. It doesn't have lines, doesn't have stripes, doesn't have nothing. I just parked somewhat close to the back door. Our main PLC showed up. Hey, are you Tom?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Well, you were here. I just don't want to get the inventory started. Is that you
parked right over there?
I'm like, yeah.
So you think you can park in the pregnant lady that has a broken leg spot? You think you need to be closer than her?
Totally gone. I'll be able to do it at 7:30 in the morning for no reason. Okay?
No, I ask.
And I take the whole conversation out of the way because he was hot. And then he got hot about other things. And then he had vehicle damage issues later. And he thought that was related to us. And I over-documented because I already knew he was hot. And I have it all laid out. You see it in some of the guides. I use that specific example. So there's many different things we can talk about. Parking. Where's the bathrooms? Don't just assume because you see a bathroom. That's the bathroom for tax. That might be the bathroom for the office. Then. And they want us to hear your tax to use the shop bathroom. Which is fine. Whatever. You know, they don't have to, but it's...
You can ask to use the bathroom. Preferably, you just use
them on your
way somewhere if you have
enough
time, correct?
Yeah, I don't have a problem with using the bathroom on a job site. What you don't do is you don't show up 10 minutes late, and the first thing you do is go to the bathroom for 10 minutes. That's that. But, you know, like yesterday, hey, man, is there a bathroom there I can use? Sometimes
they'll look right at the bathroom, look right at you, and say,
because they can't. And they
might not want us there. We're there to save somebody money. That might not be the person we're dealing with. We might be dealing with the manager of that facility, and we might be executing a rollout or a deployment from the corporate office. And the corporate office says, the office in Kainai, North Dakota needs GPS on 7 vehicles. And that six stacks a supervisor. And that supervisor might say, you're not doing my truck. And you call dispatch, and you call the client, and they say, you're doing 7. And then you get into something like that. They might legitimately not want us there. What do you got? Okay. Okay.
You can't do trouble without the IDT, correct?
You can't verify it handheld. You can call them in and verify it over the phone. They can check and see if they see it, but it doesn't.
It's not official until the IDT is used.
Right.
So that's where Jeff Conway is at.
Yeah, but I already talked to him about this morning. I told him that he doesn't have an IDT and he's not going to be able to IDT verify. And I provided him the phone number for verification.
You know,
then he's done. You know, then he can.
Nothing else he can do.
No.
You just need the IDT.
Yeah. Yeah. We're going to have to ship him one and send him back unless Trimble says it's okay not to.
Yeah.
Well, then we've got to. We already have built in the calendar for him to go back in case that was the case. Okay.
So, think about the different things within your installation.
Which truck do you want to do first? Count the appointment with the PLC. Which appointment was that? Remember the GPS technologies appointment at the installation place? We were talking to the Polish guy, and we were working on it. We did one Ford, and we did one Sterling. It was our last appointment of the day. It was drizzling. They pulled it inside. Remember we went to that guy? We got there a little bit early. The address was hard to find.
He was like, all right, cool, see you guys later. I'm like, wait, let's open this box.
Yeah, I remember, yep.
I don't want them to leave and then find out we're short equipment. I want them to be standing right there when I open that box to know, if he doesn't know me for anyone, I could have 20 felonies for theft. He would never know. You know what I mean?
Right.
And in his mind, he might just associate us with somebody that has that type of background just because he wants to or because maybe some other guy would come off, or maybe his own guy's home, whatever. But that's why we need inventory at the beginning. Okay, we got 3 units here.
All right, cool.
And what you don't want to happen is get handed a box. Say, all right, there's 25 kids in there. Have at it. And you're like, all right, cool. And then at the end of the day, there's 24. You don't know if you lost one if you only had 24 to start with. That's a horrible feeling. That's a horrible place to be. So try to open your
equipment in front of your PLC. That's not.
I'm dominating this interaction because I'm taking away your ability to say that I lost one of these by counting it right here in front of you. Now, if you and I count 25 and at the end of the day it's 24, it's on me. That's fine. Okay?
That's not fine. It's absolutely horrible and totally unacceptable, but it's at least we know the onus of responsibility of that.
When we don't know where it ends, then we get a lot of things that she said, well, you could have done this, you could have done everyone. Mine's looking for a way to get him out of it. It's a horrible place to be.
Right.
That's one thing. Inventory, bathrooms, peripheral mounting. Had a guy going to five Volkswagen Beetles for a Merry Maids or something.
Maid place, service master.
Whatever. Doesn't matter. Over here. Right over there.
And
he went and where did the car go? That's where the point. Okay? That's what I'm talking about. Where the PSP wants it.
He went into it thinking, I've done 100 garments.
I've talked to 20 POCs. They all want it right here. I'm just going to do it.
So he did it.
He left.
She said, cool, all right, thanks.
Then they looked at the vehicles the next day, and they have a company policy that only the passenger can work the garment. And it wasn't in the center of the vehicle. And we had to go back and open five little swinging beetles back up, which are not fun to open up, and then cut the slack back out so we could drag the cord in the center of the car. And we lost the ability to work profitable work. And
all the money cost us to go back and do that. So we lost two times.
And
we lost the perception of
doing what the
PSC wanted. Now,
was
their request extraordinary?
Yes.
The request was not in form.
However, it's their right to be able to make whatever request they want as the garments go. Corey and I were on
the job site in Minnesota
way back. And I don't know
if he asked or if
I asked or if both asked. We asked the guy, all right, where do you want your place? And he's in
Ford, man. He goes right here.
And Corey and I both look at each other like, are you serious? And he's like, yeah.
I want to hear facing forward so they can't do anything
with it while they're driving. They're going to have to stop and turn around with this message terminal. And I was like, wow, this guy's got safety. You know, realistically, we could have programmed the GPS units to shut off the ability to input while GPS was in motion. But at the time, that was a stretch on the technology. It was theoretically possible, but practically not practical. That makes sense.
You know, it's like you say, your phone can do this,
it can do this, it can do that, it can do this, it can do that. But try doing all these things at once for 25 days. Something's going to fail. That's what it was like. So then we had to
look at double cables.
Because they were serial cable DB9s. And because we asked, we didn't have to move any that we previously installed, and we were able to get our cable order or get it out in time where we didn't delay the job. So
we did. Any questions about this recessive domination that I'm
kind of teaching right now, I guess you would say. Has anybody ever heard of this or anybody ever thought of this
matter before?
How to go ahead and do that. Yeah, I worked in customer service for a while, so yeah, I know how to do most of this stuff.
So you know the whole thing about letting
them cool off too if they're hot. Just let them spit.
Whatever they're going to spit, let them spit.
I mean, I'm not going to show it that first day when that guy was, yelling at him.
You were just
cool doing your own thing, and I didn't say
I didn't say nothing. I just, hey, he's going to let it go out no matter what. And why antagonize him and make it worse?
Right. So nothing good. Yeah. They're going to see low voltage issues.
Doesn't matter. Everything else doesn't matter.
Perceptually, in the
annals of history,
nobody's going to go. They're just going to
issue
low voltage, and that's what we're trying to avoid. All right. Inventory.
Discuss mounting time frames. Hey, how long is that truck going to take?
Over
promise.
Under
promise, over
deliver.
Oh, it'll be about an hour.
Get it done. 45 minutes. You know what I'm saying?
Don't tell 45 minutes.
What took an hour? Why did it take an hour? Doesn't matter. The hour is off by 50. No worries.
Come on, your mouth.
Change this guy's schedule. You know what I mean? Might as well just follow up the excuses and throw them over there. Sorry. Could be reasons, too. Still. Might not.
Might be verification. Cell network could be down.
power harness broke, we shipped this used equipment that was missing a pin, and we custom engineered the solution. Yeah, never know. Never know.
Sometimes you're doing
trucks one at a time, and then bringing them off the road to cycle in, to cycle back out. And your lead time from truck to truck needs to be very accurate, but you also need to be able to play your POC. If you're on, everybody
conceptually, when we go some.
Okay. So
if you have, you're working on truck number one, he says, how long until you're done?
I need at least 20 minutes. Tell me when you're 20 minutes from being done. 20 minutes from being done. And then 40 minutes later, the truck shows up. The next time, tell me if the 20 minutes from being done, 3 minutes from being done.
See if it shows up on time or if it still shows up 10 minutes
late. If it's still 40 minutes, then tell me 40 minutes before you're done, 20 minutes from being done. You know what I'm saying?
Keep those trucks coming in, but you can't
be like,
I'll be done in 5 minutes.
It's like an hour and a half. Because these
trucks ultimately make more money on the road
than it costs to have us there and install the system. So
that's one of the reasons we get no-show a lot, because paying the no-show fees on our appointments
is drops in the bucket compared to what these vehicles are capable of earning in a day. I mean, some trucks you work on go make $20,000 a day. Oh,
guess what? Truck 13 on my 12 truck fleet got called because somebody wanted to pay another $20,000 to have another truck. Sorry, your one install was canceled. You know what I mean?
So,
while no shows are annoying, just
ultimately you mentally prepare to go do work, and work isn't there, and it's kind of a weird energy, kind of internal energy management that a no show causes, and it can sometimes be mentally anguishing. Think about the whole financial picture of a no show, and ultimately what a small effect we are. That truck, you know. Now, some POCs, the return on investment is so great that they'll shut the truck down, they'll tell the mechanics, they'll leave, pull the spark plug, do whatever you got to do, that truck ain't going, I need to get a GPS today. You know, and normally there's money on the other side of that. There's a guy who's what we call a dodger, who's been the straggler on that 4 month situation, who's the supervisor who doesn't want it done, who goes out for lunch and breaks down. Can't get back to the shop for an install, or the mechanics in New York that took 150 sets of keys home, so we couldn't work on any trucks one night. We were doing Horizon's fleet. Yeah, they're there. They're out there. Okay? Help Dodgers. And all they're doing is living on stolen time, because we're going to get them sooner or later. We talked about bathrooms.
Let's talk about smoking.
Don't assume you can smoke on a customer's property. We took a team.
Once again, we referenced the map. Mm-hmm.
We took a team of almost 14 people from Illinois. One of them drove in from the East Coast. And we drove all the way out to Medford, Oregon, which is right over there. Okay?
And after 2 full days of driving, dealing with closed roads, closed passes, slip outs, spin outs, weird hotels in the middle of nowhere in Nevada. Great food, horrible food, everything. We get there, everybody gets out, they're starting to get their game face on, they're stretching.
5 guys at the top. We're at a company that does about $30 to $40 million a year worth of business. They have 2,200 vehicles in their fleet, and this is day one, site one, truck one. And manager of the whole thing comes out. Who said they could smoke in here? That was our first impression. We had to spend the next 21 days with these people going from site to site to site, and the first thing we did was make them angry because we were ignorant to where we could smoke. They were at OSHA-regulated no-smoking area. If OSHA was present, we would have shut the whole site down, and about 50 to 70 people would have been sent home paid, and they would have been fined, and it would have been our fault because of a cigarette. 4 or 5. So, ask. Just because you're outside doesn't mean it's okay. Ask the POC, hey, I'm a smoker. Where is the designated smoking area? 90% of the time, oh man, just don't do it inside. I don't want to pick up your butts, blah, blah, blah. Some guys are not smoking their mouth and tell you you can't smoke in their shop. Okay? That's fine. It's your shop. Cool. If you take that, you go,
you're smoking,
where are you going to go with that? You're not going to dump the driver's license. Just keep moving.
Parking, yard access. I want to come back to yard access. PPE requirements. I was on site in Philadelphia.
I was wearing shorts. It was hot. Had my
radio on.
Anyway, so I'm out
there and I'm in shorts.
Nobody
said anything to me.
I'm
looking around.
And everybody else
in pants.
I got a hard hat on. I got a hard
hat on.
But I got shorts on. But everybody else is in pants. So I asked my POC, real nice lady, don't remember her name. Hey, POC, should I be in pants? Just saying, everybody else is in pants. You're in pants. It's like 105 out on fire wearing pants, but should I be in pants? She goes, you know, I was going to let it slide, but yes, you should be in pants. You know, that's our PPE, that's our OSHA rules here, is that you have to be in pants because we do grinding over there and the shards can come out and blah, blah, blah. All right, I'm going to put some pants on. So she was trying to be nice. Okay. But her being nice about it, I was just like, well, I'm not going to say anything because I want to wear my shorts. And then OSHA shows up and shuts down the whole site and finds them, and it gets back up the chain. That was a deck hard job. Gets back up to that car that we didn't get the installs done, and we shut their site down, and they got a fine call because I didn't wear pants. That sounds way worse than I thought it would, but you know what I'm saying. So
if everybody has a hard hat but you, chances are you should have a hard hat.
Ask someone to make sure. We don't want any favors when it comes to PPE, because that whole niceness was actually endangering me to the shards from the grinder. See what I'm saying? But they just don't want to be that person that's like, don't put some pants on. You know, they want to want to feel like a kindergarten teacher. So I put myself in a recessive position to make sure that they were taken care of and I was taken care of. It was a little bit hotter that day for me. So when you look at the grand scheme of things, how that day could go out,
that's a little more water.
Extra, you know? Right, that's what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. When you're talking to your POC, we want to know yard access. In the hours of the yard, how long can we be in the yard? Will you be my point of contact the whole time I'm here, especially on larger jobs? You know, this job is scheduled for 12 hours today. Who do I talk to when you leave? What's your cell phone number? Don't assume that the number we have in the appointment is the point of contact's actual cell number. You know? Give me a reason why the point of contact cell number is better than going to look for the point of contact. It's direct to them, okay? But what does that affect for you? How does that affect you and your pocketbook and your job? If we're not recording, I'm going to sit down for a second.
Because you got to go ahead and go find someone to find.
Okay, yeah. Time management.
Even if you're getting the third person involved, you'll find you're going to be 10, 15 people.
What if they leave? Now you got their cell phone number. It doesn't matter if they're on site or not. It could be, they say they want the Garmin right here in every truck. You say, fine, five trucks in, the dash is totally different, or there's something else already there. Gauges, Garmin, air brake, PTO, whatever. You can't just guess, because we're going to put holes in the dash. If you just guess and they don't like it, or even if they do like it and they just know that you didn't ask, some people are just like that. Oh, you didn't ask me and you put holes there, so now that's definitely not where I want it. I want a new dashboard. I want a new panel. You know? You call the PLC, you don't have to go find them, you don't have to walk around, you don't have to. You just save yourself a lot of time. And if they're not there and you have a secondary point of contact number, who can make decisions if I can't get a hold of you? That's kind of how I ask it. Am I on your way? Oh, sorry. Go ahead. Ah, oh, my feet are killing me, but I'm just keeps me alert.
Okay.
Oh, okay. I just wore the wrong shoes today, Marcus. Let's see. The yard access and the hours is a big deal because let's say you're doing an install, it takes an hour and a half, or let's say you're doing an install, it takes 30 minutes, but it might take you an hour and a half for verification or some problem. Maybe the wire's real short. Maybe you pull on a wire for some slack and you unplug it 3 feet down the line, and now you're taking apart 6 extra panels to plug back in whatever the heck you accidentally unplugged. Done it in Omaha as my last job of the day before I drove all the way back to Chicago. Cost me an extra hour and a half. Yes, I've done it. Okay, I'll just get over there. So, if you know that the yards are hard closed at 4 p.m., their union job at 4:01 starts making $30 an hour instead of 20. Okay. That's a big deal. You don't want to be the reason to find contact paying all this extra labor. You don't want to start a truck at 3:50 thinking you have all night and then have it totally disassembled and they walk over and they go, we close in a minute. No exceptions. Gates closed, dogs get released, cops get called, motion in the air. We've had this happen. Okay? No one you're going to close this and play your strength to get there in the most efficient manner you can. Also, ask them, you know, if there's 12 to do and you're not going to make it unless you stay another 3 hours past the close, ask them, what are my options past that time? Is there any way I can get away? Is there any way the last 2 vehicles can be parked outside the fence? The lock marks with the keys. What can we do that will help me complete as much as possible here? Because ultimately, that is part of how you can pull your income. Right now, you may be looking at the schedules going, I'm only going to be able to do what they put in front of me. That's the only way I can make money, right? Not true. Not true. When you have an appointment that's 5, and you get 5, you clear that. You make room for something else. Okay? When you have an appointment that's 5 and you get 4, that 1 is going to take way more time later. Yeah, maybe your drive time. I mean, we pay you accordingly, but the more vehicles you can push through in a week, the more profitable you're going to be. So ultimately, you're going to get efficient, you're going to get faster, you're going to get your tools boiled down, and we're a long way from that. I'll probably stay working 2-3 months away from any of you guys being able to walk into any situation and feel 100% confident and be able to knock it out, okay? That takes a while.
For example, I'm just right now that, let's say we have 4 or 5 on the schedule and, you know, we get 4 of them done and it's already 8 o'clock, PLC's not answering.
Like 8 p.m.?
Yeah.
And you can't find a safe vehicle?
Yeah. And then, well, let's
say, PLC let's stay all five are going to be there, or is it not coming?
The fifth one is there, but yard's closed, nobody's allowed in the yard. How do we go about rescheduling them? Do we got to take it up first thing in the morning the next day, or do they got to reschedule with?
No, they got to get a dispatch. You will not have that ability because the next day you'll be scheduled somewhere else. Unless you're there multiple days, in which case, yeah, I just start the next day. But here in Chicago, you're going to be scheduled somewhere else. We are getting busier. And the angle of the other thing is right now it's me and Tino in Chicago. Sorry, Tino, you and I. But we're all three not going to be here at the same time very often between travel, projects, trainings and other responsibilities that I have with high-end trials, and there's just too much. I mean, and we have two more Chicago women because we really, yeah, one's going to be a key hub, one's going to be a travel slash software stack. So, but let's talk about that after training. There's a manual on drive if you take a look at it. It's pretty self-explanatory, but we'll talk about it after training. So yard hours and practice hours are a pretty big part of making sure your day is successful, especially when you start getting into the do as many as possible jobs. Like, they have 150 of them are here, you're only here for a day and a half, do as many as you can. That's when it's really important that when the yard closes. Now, if you decide to be an Ironman, okay, some days you might just be like, I'm on time, I have nothing to do but go back to this hotel, and everyone in these trucks is money for me. I'm just going to, you know, bring some food on site, put my headphones in, and I'm just gonna rock, and I'm in a groove, and I'm going, and I'm making a 12-day, 10-hour day, 12-hour day, 14-hour day, 16-hour day, whatever it is, you're just grooving. You're knocking them out. That's great. You can do that, but it does not change your sales force and work order requirements at all. Okay, don't think because you did 2 extra trucks, you don't have to do your work notes in your sales force. So when you think about, I want to be totally done, I want to shut my mind down at 10 p.m., don't start your last truck. See what I'm saying? Because, you know, hey, but I did one more vehicle than I was supposed to. It's great. It doesn't change the requirement.
Okay.
So calculate that into your day when you're planning. When you feel your body tell you it's time to stop installing, and you're on one of these, you know, your HIPAA jobs, because it's like as much as you can do, you can eat. All right. Think about the documentation still must happen. If it was just install, I'm sure you'd get one or two more trucks. You know, if you didn't have to take any pictures, I'm sure you could do more vehicles. But that quantity can't sacrifice your quality. So just something to think about. I've fallen into that trap many times myself. Well, I did five extra trucks, but now I'm too tired to do my paperwork. Not conducive to success. Not worth it. How long will the POC be on site? Who's replacing them? What's the replacement phone number? Keys. Oh yeah. Keys. Let's talk about some best practices for keys. Okay? Because we can win or lose a lot of perception with keys. Number one, inventory keys when you are handed keys. Somebody goes,
here's the box. There's 50 sets of keys in there.
I'd
say, you know what? Hold on. Is it okay if I sit right here and count these? I'll make sure all 50 are in here.
Okay. Do it. Take the time. Dedicate that 3 minutes, that 4 minutes, that 5 minutes that it's going to take you to count 50 sets of keys. Because when you are at the end of the day and you don't count and there's 49 sets, you're going to lose 10 times that amount looking for a phantom set of keys that maybe you never even received. I can't
tell you how many times somebody said, all right, here's all 10 sets, and I found like, oh, there's 9. And I'm like, no, there's 10, there's this.
This. I go, that one's not in here. And they go, really? Oh. Here it is. Oh.
I did drop that. Oh, it's in my office. Oh, where is that truck?
Well, that was in service. Oh, you know. But if
you don't do it right then and there.
The
second you walk away from that POC, we own all those keys.
And
personally, I prefer to take one big cable tie,
not 50 sets. 50 sets, I might do 5 cable ties of 10. But if it's 10 to 15 sets of keys, I cable tie them all together. Because if I'm going to lose one, I'd rather lose them all. Because then they're going to be easier to find because they're all together. Same thing
with the alarms.
Those two remotes, first thing I do is put those two remotes together. Because if I lose one remote, I'd rather
walk them both. So what else? Inventory the keys.
Put keys together.
Cable tie.
How about where should the keys go?
What have you done? Where do you want the keys?
Do you want
them in the truck?
Do you want the
truck locked?
Do you want
the truck as I found it?
Who do I
give the keys to? Will you be here? Will anyone be here?
Maybe
they give you 5 sets of keys and they say, all right, we're leaving.
The trucks are over there. We have the equipment. Call me.
Need you.
Cool.
What am I doing with these keys?
Am I locking
them in the trucks?
Is there a
key drop box?
Where do they go?
Where is the keys home? Am I hanging them back up in the lock box?
When the
keys are headed home, I take
a picture of them. If they say,
home, just take all 10 sets and leave them over here on the handle of my office.
Take all 10 sets. I lay it out. Take a picture and identify 10 sets. If I had to, my photo, hang them on the
door, I take a picture of them hanging on the door,
and I'm out.
Also, if you're the last one on the guard, unrelated to keys, how do I secure the guard? Is there a gate I need to close? Is there a lock I need to throw? Do you want a text message or a phone call when I leave the yard? That way you know I'm gone. If anything happens afterwards, it's documented that I am not here.
By asking these questions, you take away the ability for the point of contact to blame anything that happens after you leave the yard on us.
I have a ridiculous story. This is part of why I like this portion of training so much.
Is it
jogged my memory and all these stories from the field of all these anomalies that have happened over my 10 years in GPS,
or telematics, or fleet electronics, whatever you want to call it. I'm out in southeastern Denver at a roofing company, SRS.
So
who's their
equipment?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. And they're having all kinds of problem.
There was a previous installer that went out there.
And, like, I don't know if he just didn't own cable ties. And he or she didn't
have cable ties. Everything was
taped. Poking.
Just tape. Wow.
Bundle
of wires, just tape. Horrible. No
PTOs connected. Tons of issues. Poor investment. So I'm cleaning up like 15 trucks, right? And I'm there day after day, right? So the last day was a Friday that I left early. And I had driven to Colorado Springs that night when I was done. I had been hearing all the stories about how they're in kind of a bad neighborhood and how they keep getting their catalytic converters stolen. They keep getting their spare tires and rims stolen. Somebody stole the forklift
over there, lowered it off the back of the truck and drove it off the yard. So she's like, make sure you lock the gate when you leave.
So
okay, what I can do is there a code? Is there no? Just say that lock the gate when you leave.
Do you need a call when you leave? What time
are you going to leave? Probably about 11 o'clock at night.
Nope, don't call. It's too late. Okay.
I go leave.
Lock me. I'm thinking there's $3 million worth of trucks in there. I can't get the lock to close. I got to call her. I think her name is Veronica. I called her up. I can't get this lock to close. She goes, oh, that lock's been broken for months. Yeah.
So I took a picture of it.
I made
it look as secure as possible. I took a picture of it.
I called it over. You know? But if I don't do that,
then you use a catalytic converter. You're going to be looking at me. Look at us.
Anything else with the keys?
Yeah, make sure you leave a window open so that you don't lock them in.
Yes. That applies to semis too. Not just what I like to call residential vehicles. You know, non-commercial vehicles. What would you call that? Think of a better term. Let me know. Window down.
Just enough to get an arm in there. It doesn't have to be all the way down.
I don't want to sit there in the rain getting wet because we talked about putting the window down here on a whiteboard.
No, and I that's good.
But yeah, that
is a very good point.
Drop a window. Drop a window. Any other questions regarding keys and key management? Okay.
Oh, there's one thing I forgot.
If
there is a grate on the ground, it's a sewer drain, or a water drain, or a manhole, or anything, and you are holding keys, do not walk over it. Walk around it. I've got a Zoom appointment for a grease trap cleaning and fire halon suppression restaurant company where they clean the filters, the grease filters, and the overhead exhaust ducts. Within 10 minutes of being there, the guy got five sets of keys. He was training me.
Okay.
This is a guy who,
I won't tell you what, he doesn't work there.
He was training me. This was our first day in the field.
And he's
like, all right, five sets of keys, cool. And he's walking, he's holding equipment, he's holding keys, and there's a grate. And one key slipped out,
and it has
hit the ground, and he's walking, he kicked it.
And it went
down.
Like a
hole in one in the sewer drain.
That was the key to the truck that had to leave first. Yeah. And then
we were out with flashlights
and magnets and coat hangers and string, and spent the next hour and a half trying to fish a key out of the sewer drain. Yeah. Day one. Okay, so it
sounds ridiculous.
Well, of course, I'm not going to drop the key down there. Just don't even
walk over it. Don't even tempt Murphy
to flex his law or her law. Murphy's a girl. I don't know. So,
you might have some time to say very
gender neutral.
I have seen
some very efficient female technicians in the field as well. I want to give them their due.
Keys, where they go, where they come from, where they go when they're done. Discuss the vehicle state, lock
the windows up, down. You might get to a vehicle, all the windows should be down. Rain is coming. Do we want to
roll them up?
Are they broken? Should we not roll them up?
Say, hey,
how do you want
the vehicle? Same way I left them.
If they're unlocked, you can get there, leave them unlocked, whatever. It's a quick conversation with you. And what do you do when you do that? Right. You're dominating that situation by being your
excessive party in the conversation.
So now
we've actually got to our institution portion. Okay? We've talked about batteries, we've checked our maps, we've fueled up our car, we've driven on site, we've arrived on time, we've talked to the POC, we know what's up with the keys, we've inventoried the equipment, we've gone over any peripheral mounts if necessary. We know when the air closes, we have their phone number. Talk about everything else that we've just gone over, and now it's time to actually do some installs. And I think we started this conversation early in the week, but I'm not sure if I finished it. Well, what we've been doing is I'm trying to show you my formula, or low voltage formula for installations. If you follow the formula, you can get to a specific level of speed, efficiency, and cognitive ability, and just overall, if you follow the formula, you will get to a proven level. You'll at least be this good. Okay, wherever the ceiling is on this level, I don't know. You'll get the year, wherever that is. Okay? And then from there, once you can properly execute that formula, then take your mind to think about how to make it better. How could I improve on this? Because a lot of times in training classes, I get tons of questions right off the bat. Well, what if you did it this way? It's like, you haven't even been in this situation yet. Let's try and not tell me how you can do it better when you've even done it once. You know, I don't mean from an ego standpoint. I just mean that from an overall experience. You can have the best plan in the world. In 20 minutes into your install, you got to change the thing because of something you never even accounted for. Okay? If you run this process the way I've been treating it this week and the way I've been having you guys do it, you will be at least X good, and that is good for level 2, and from there we'll move on. I do my paperwork first. Not everybody has the same mindset. For me, if I don't do the paperwork first, I forget something. I need to switch from paperwork mode to install mode, paperwork mode, in order for it to be successful. And now that we have the QC chats, I take all the pictures first. Then I use the pictures to populate my work order. That way I'm not sitting here doing yoga, trying to write down the numbers and door jams. I'm not bending over trying to read license plates. I'm not trying to hold units up against my chest and up the clipboard while I'm writing it down in the rain. Take all the pictures first, then do your paperwork. One of the things that does is make sure your pictures are legible. Okay? So you are basically proofing your own pictures by doing that. And you can sit in the vehicle, right? In winter or raining, that's going to be a time advantage plus just an overall working, living condition advantage as you're verifying your pictures. So you populate the work order with your pictures. You do your pre-check. Okay? You got your serial number written down. Then you have an install plan. You look at the vehicle and think, okay, I should be able to get the unit somewhere in this area. Looks like ground over there, and this is the ignition harness. Okay. Fish it. Then wire it. Verify it as you're tightening up and reassembling it. A lot of people confuse speed with efficiency. We'll just go efficient. I'm a pretty neat installer, not the best speller. Okay. Speed is a speed of mind, a pace of processing, a want to be fast, a disregard for unnecessary processes. Okay? My girl's calling me. I need to get this stuff done. I'll talk to her later. That's a speed decision. Okay? There's an amount of hustle that comes out with speed. Some people have what I call a third gear when it comes to speed. Diego, I think I can see it in you pretty strongly. And once you get efficient, I think you're going to be just your high motor guy. You can talk fast. You know? And I'm not saying anything negative, where people have different skill sets and different traits. It makes us all unique and individual. But ultimately, you can only try to be fast so much. And typically, when you start to get close to the edge of that, starting to be fast, you start breaking things, whether it's your car or your process. Okay? So there's speed, which is not what I teach. What I teach is being efficient, doing things specific order, doing things at the same time. Why do we connect ground first and then cross it? Okay.
Why? So we don't damage it again.
Okay. What else?
Power up the unit is already
alive. Right.
As soon as you start wrapping
that conductor,
it's already alive.
Unless
it's a Gen X unit, which then you take
the ignition and you tap it positive, and that wakes it up.
Right.
But we didn't run into that this week, so I could share that. And you'll see
by the light sign, as soon as I pass it,
me on, then you'll tap it. Come on, so I
was using a constant going into that ignition,
and it starts to quiet. So then you're multitasking, you know,
by taking the pictures and then doing your paperwork,
being efficient, making sure your pictures are good and you don't have to retake any. Being efficient
the second you're done writing down your serial numbers and
vehicle info, you're already positioned to do the pre-check. You may have already started the vehicle while you're writing the numbers down, you know. And you're looking, and as soon as you're writing the numbers down, you're hitting the turn signals, you're checking out the windows, the wipers, and everything else. You're pre and post checking like we did this week. They should be like 2 minutes max. We're not checking to see if the HVAC goes from the defrost floor, see if it's cold in the winter, summer. Yeah.
Radio sound
done. Not left speaker. Only paying 105 hertz. You know, so you think
about what parts of your process you can blend together. Verification and reassembly.
Easy blend. Okay.
Unit wiring and operation wiring.
Easy blend. Okay.
Taking a picture of your work order while you're on the phone verifying. Packing up your tools while you're verifying.
Talking to verification while you're cable tying your wire connections. While you're starting to put panels back on. That's one of the reasons Bluetooth is a tool. It should be on your required tools list. We have to have it. Having a clipboard that can store FD work orders is sufficient because if you pull it right out, you pull it back to the car, you're writing through the folder and right, marking and all that. So efficiency is what we're aiming for. And the more vehicles you do, the more things you notice you can blend together. And a lot of this is tools. You know, you look at my tool bag, that's a little tool bag, there's a couple of tools in there, whatever. Ah, he likes to bolt. So what? Every tool in there is there for a specific reason. It's a quick stripper. It's a quick cutter. This is the quickest way I can test wires with a power probe. This is the quickest way I can crimp. I'm looking at some custom crimper. You know, I'm doing a 10-gauge wire. I have a specific stripper that gets me in and out of a 10-gauge wire quickly. I have a specific couple of bits in this. I don't care the whole four. I don't need four. I need these specific ones. You know, my bin worked out of has my 7 emails and everything in it. It has what I use most right there, accessible. If you need something more, I can just go to my secondary bag. And the more jobs you do, the less tools you keep in your primary tool bag. So that
it's efficiency,
not speed, that we're aiming for. Okay? There's only
so much hustle
that you can do. Because
you can hustle all the way through
the install, but if the last wire you connect is ground, all the hustle in the world is
get you back for 3 or 4 minutes downloading the scripts and configuration and acquiring the GPS. Flipping the ignition on and off while we're reassembling before we call the verify makes our verification call more efficient.
If you find out that you're having a 10-minute hold time on verification, start calling in 10 minutes before you're ready to verify. We were doing stuff for the U.S. Marine Corps for network fleet, and they were sold to 10 because they were running like 100 unit deployments 10 wide. The U.S. and only had 5 people in the call center, that
as soon as we hung up,
we would call back in and sit on.
By the time they picked up, we were already done with the next week.
That's the efficiency that you want to get to, and that's the mindset that you want to be in. Mimi?
No, just Phil Smith. Take a break.
Okay. I probably at least 20 minutes from a break. Okay. Your install
plan and your install layout makes a big difference. If you just know you can get power here, you just start getting your power and don't know where you're going to put your unit, and you only have power quarters a meter long,
you may install yourself in the corner. Have
that general layout of where things are going to
go. It looks like whoever did that deck art is circling and installed themselves in the corner, didn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Or that one that you had to move back up behind the glove box, that person installed themselves in the corner. Tell by the way it's installed. They didn't
go over here
with that unit. They just started running wires and then, oh. antenna unit replacements. Now, a lot of the antennas we install have an option of being placed inside the dash or on the glass. Okay, they both have their benefits and their drawbacks. What are some of the benefits of mounting it on the glass, aka the windshield? No possible covering without being external to the vehicle. Clear view of the sky. Right. If you install
an antenna on the glass breaks,
what happens? Not
when we install it, but
months later.
If it's installed on the glass,
and somebody comes up to change the windshield, they got to take it off. They're going
to take the antenna off. But
are they going to put it back? Probably
not. So we get some failure there. I'm a driver. I'm angry.
I don't think anybody's watching the GPS.
I just don't want to be tracked.
I'm a lone wolf. There's an antenna
on the glass.
Got it. Right? Increased tampering. On the other hand, more satellites on the glass. So
the standard somewhat depends on the client. Sometimes I just ask for the
customers, or the client.
Sometimes lots of customers in the POC, hey,
I can put this antenna on the glass, I can bury it in the dash, totally unseen. What do you want? I want it in a dash. Okay. Then we put it in the dash and simply layer the metal boards over the top of the dash. POC in the dash on your paperwork, right? We get out of that situation. If we have to
remove an antenna off the windshield,
what is the only approved tool?
Panel.
No, sir. Not a panel popper. Nope. We talked about this. I'll make a good point. We'll see what you got when I get back. Huh?
Yep.
Talked to you guys this week. Somebody asked me what it was for on the tool list. All right. Time's up. The Bondo Springer.
That's what I was trying to say. That's what I
said.
The panel.
You said panel popper. That's a spatula.
That's a putty knife.
See, that's what I was trying to say. Putty knife. That's what I was asking about. I do remember asking about.
Mm-hmm. That's you can't have any prying force on the inside of a window. Outside of a window,
not a problem. Inside of a window,
broken. So, I'm not even going to say you can put three because I don't want to.
I don't want to.
No, I mean, with. Don't.
If it's the dead of winter and the antenna has full 3M VHB, what does VHB stand for?
Mm-hmm. It's for double side tape, stands for very high voltage. It's the
stuff that they use to
hold body molding on, also what they use to keep windows and skyscrapers taped in nowadays. Yeah, good stuff. If you're looking at a full strip. You're looking at a frozen windshield covered in ice. I take the antenna off.
Start the truck, get the defrost going, take that spatula,
and just kind of work it slowly. Or call me and take a picture. We might just tell them the whole thing off in the summer. You know what I mean? Because they can
say, take it off, on and off.
The windshield breaks. You broke the windshield. Totally. Totally.
We talked about power sources. Do we need to discuss where to get
constant ground?
Do we need to discuss all the different tools you have to help you find a reliable place for constant ground? Let's talk about text for a little bit.
Your power pro is coming in tomorrow? Awesome.
Okay. Low Voltage is an installer owned and operated company, which gives us a key advantage over any of our competitors in the marketplace. You can talk to the CEO, COO, and still have a conversation about relays. Okay, you can't do that with our competitors.
Some corporate company is just, you know, trying to I mean, everybody's trying to generate revenue, so I guess I can't fill them there. But realistically, we understand what's going on the ground way more than our competitors, which is what is attributed to our growth, of course, our future success. So one of the ways we've gotten there is with our technician support. This isn't just technical support. This is technician support. Okay, you have a 5 or 6 monster here that are ways that you can be supported with that field. That's cool. Okay? What's one way that we issue technicians while in the QC chat? Okay? Who
all sees your QC chat?
No.
Not true.
Diego
can't see yours, you can't see Diego's.
Right? Director of CTD. Okay, who else?
Yes, field labs, kind of. But not really, only specific numbers.
Okay, so number one, number two, Glenn. Okay. Yeah, I got to put your second name on there. Bernard
Charles.
Right? Yeah. But I don't want to specifically name Bernard, because what I want to show you here is that all level 4 technicians will be in your chat. All level 3 technicians are going to be in your chat as well, okay? Plus Corey, the CEO.
Now, he's not really watching your chats real time.
Corey has way better things to do throughout the day than sit and watch everybody's every picture that comes in. However, I do not have any better things to do in the day. That is part of my responsibility, Bernard's responsibility, and level 3 responsibilities, is to make sure that your installs are not only company standard, but efficient. You know, if we see it's taking you 2 hours to do a Ford F-150 for Fleetmatics, we're going to give you a call and be like, hey, how can we help? What's going on out there? You might just be like, oh, I got a really hard call from my family. I just took a break from half an hour, and I'll still get everything done on time. Okay, cool. It's not a problem, you know. But you might say, you know, this one panel is really killing me. I'm going to take a picture. Oh, that could look like this. You know, don't be afraid to ask those questions. So QC chats are an amazing tool. Now, what are some things that should not be in the QC chat?
Just idle chatter.
Idle chatter. Okay. HR
questions.
Okay.
Don't forget who's in these chats.
Don't go in these chats and complain about Bernard when he can see you. You know what I mean? Bernard's a great guy. Anything HR, anything payroll,
travel-related stuff, chat's not a good place for it.
It's really technical support and training. You know, certifications. We can talk certs in your chats, things like that. All right, tools. You want to talk about a new tool or a cool way you found to do something? You can do that. We can talk about tools, make the software more efficient. So that's just one portion of your technician support. What's another technician support? Okay, let's do that. Yeah, let's wire identification help, right? So let's just call that one documentation.
Sitting here just thinking of simple words to say.
Hey, that's cool. We're being interactive. We're doing some learning. We're doing some interactive learning. That's what we want to do. Documentation for its direct text. I'm just going to shorten that up to DEI. Whether it's Google Drive, because we've done some cool things in there. Email. Anything else? Okay. Do you know about the technician support line? We didn't really need it this week because I was standing right there, but yes. The technician support line, the technician hotline. That line has options for dispatch, has options for travel-related questions, has options for payroll HR-related, and has options for technical support. When you call that, you get the option of technical support or bringing yourself. All in four of them are level threes. All are from range ones. First one to pick up gets it. Okay. I prefer you use that versus call me directly. And I say that because if I'm busy, then I'm costing you time. And then I also think that you need to talk specifically to me, which means now you're in my queue to follow up with, and I might not have to. Plus, it allows us to look at the metrics from the technician support line and know that it was, one, worth setting up and paying for, two, who's calling, who might need more on-site training, you know, if I look at, or we look at the data from the technician support line, we see that you know, our Montana technician calls 50 times a month, and the next closest is 25. Maybe we need some more training out there, or maybe we need to examine why he's calling. Is he calling for technical support? Might need more training. Calling for travel? We might need to look and see why he's calling for travel so much. That helps us identify internal opportunities. But if we know he's using it, then we don't get that data. Okay? Plus, you never know what time someone's awake. We need technical support on this. It has no filter for time. 24 hours a day. Okay? Who's ever awake, so rather. And if you can't get a hold of anyone, then start calling us individually. Can't get a hold of anyone, plug line. Just keep calling people. You know? What's another option we have for technician support? This one. This one, that's already good. Technician conference call every week. Get on the same page. Make sure we're all on the same page. Tuesday morning, 10:30 a.m. Central, 11:30 a.m. D.C. It's in your calendar. So is the inbox. So the conference call number, everything's in there. Here's an obvious one that you may not have thought of. Glenn. Up here, we talked about who was in your QC chat. Here, we are talking about how are you actually being supported. Okay? You have two people that you can call. Two people that you should be diverted between. Actually, three. Glenn, myself, and Dispatch, and Keisha, so four. Okay? All which can be contacted via the technician support line. But ultimately, if you have a question, sure where it should go, Glenn. Okay, now Glenn supports our technician base as a whole. Okay, so consider if you call Glenn at 10 a.m. and leave him a voicemail, and it's 10:30 and you don't have a response, don't start calling everybody under the sun if it's not a pressing issue. Give him the time to get back to you, he will. Calls are answered in the order of urgency. Sometimes we have people trying to make last-minute flights. We have clients call us with ridiculous asks. Hey, can you have a guy on a plane to Canada tonight to go do one install tomorrow? That's happened to us. Hey, remember that quote that I sent you 6 months ago? Well, it's a go and it wants to start Monday. Can you have six guys in Jersey on Monday? Hey, an AT&T tower just came down in Rhode Island. Can you do 100 installs this weekend? It's Thursday. These are calls we received. Okay? So just consider that when we're looking at our difference. So you're very well supported. Okay? I really want to make sure that you guys aren't out there with an issue and you're not saying something. Okay? Because we care and we're here and we've paid for the phones to contact us. We've paid for the email addresses. We've gotten you your uniforms. We're not even charging you for your shirts. You know what I mean? Let us get involved and help with what it is you're dealing with, whether it's just a vehicle or payroll or travel or whatever it is. If it's causing pain, let us get involved. Okay? Not everybody sees everything all the time from here. You know? We all understand, not all, I guess, you know, there are dispatchers that haven't been on jobs, but We have a vast technical knowledge within the building that to understand the industry. I mean, Corey was a field technician for 6 or 7 years. He's slept in his car waiting for trucks before. He's driven 6 hours each way to an appointment on Thanksgiving with his family sitting at home. I mean, he's done some really astounding things in this industry to take care of some customers and some clients. And his drive, as well as the drive of a lot of our management staff, is part of how we got here. Okay, I'm not saying I can call you and tell you to drive 12 hours on Thanksgiving. I'm just saying, you know, these are things that we've done in the past. It's too bad that part didn't get recorded. But, okay, good.
So, I'm just saying, we understand. We've been in hundreds of hotels. We've gone through almost every airport in the U.S. We understand
a lot of what you're going to do in the field. So, let us help support you. Any questions on the technician support system? Okay. Any questions in general? All right.
I want to get into a little bit deeper nuts and bolts installation theory, even though we've already done a lot of this in the field. We've talked dash metal versus chassis metal.
Haven't
covered paint scraping, but I want to get into all that.
So let's
break for about 10 minutes. Now that Marcus just
reset the video up. Sorry, Marcus. Let's
break for 10 minutes, come back at 2:31,
and
get into some more nuts and bolts installed.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah, I know you just set the video back, but that's kind of how it laid out. Oh, you guys can still hear me? I'll pause. I'll mute my mic.
Yeah. When you were out talking, when I was hearing everything you were saying, I was like,
Now I got to call Joe Smith.
Mic unmuted. Test, test, test. Audio test. Testing. Testing, 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 testing. Test. Stabilis. Low voltage. GPS. Azimuth. Horizontal delusional plane. L1, L2. Testing. You hear me? Awesome. Cool. All right. Welcome back. Now, any questions from the last segment or the next segment before we get into that segment? All right. So, I want to talk a little bit about installation. We talked about grounds. Who was I in the vehicle with when we were talking about soft to soft, hard to hard with panel care? Okay, Tazelle, you ever heard that before?
I heard from about Diego.
Okay, so you guys, okay. You passed it along. We talked about how crimping is directional. We've gone over what PTOs are. Diego, do you understand PTOs, what they are, what they do? Power takeoff? Okay, there's two, when you think of PTO, there's actually two definitions. There's the real world definition, which is power takeoff, and it's only present on like dump trucks, garbage trucks, tow trucks, it's real popular in. Then there's PTO as dispatchers use it, and I don't mean just here at low voltage, I mean globally. They call every input a PTO. So you could have to like a door trigger, and they'll call it a PTO. Because in their mind, PTO means input. But in the real world, PTO is it's a gear that gets engaged in the side of the transfer case so that you can run a hydraulic pump. Like when a tow truck's working the levers and moving the bed around, that's because the PTO is pumping hydraulic fluid and they're valving those to make it actuate. Okay? When we go to engage PTOs, we need to be very, very careful. PTOs can be very dangerous. If a PTO, one of those valves, gets stuck in a position, which happens all the time, you may have a truck, right, like this. You got your tow truck, and you got a winch right here, and it goes back, and it's got just hooked on the back. You ever see a tow truck driver out with their winch just hooked in, ready to go? That way they don't have to pull it all the way out every time. If the lever is stuck in a position and you engage the PTO inside the truck, and it starts coiling, it's going to flip up off the edge and throw that hook into the truck right in the back of your head or into the back of the cab. I don't mean to be so graphic. I'm just saying it's dangerous. So when you have a PTO to connect, ask your POC, hey, can somebody engage the PTO and show me how you use it? I want to make sure I'm going to connect it right. Okay? I want to make sure it's safe. Because if they come out and engage the PTO and break their bed and smash the rear window, Right. And I want you guys to be safe out there. PTO is very dangerous. Don't leave a PTO engaged for a long amount of time, if at all possible. Another PTO story is there was a company that moved limestone powder called Predator Trucking out in eastern Ohio. And one of their facilities in western Pennsylvania had a PTO, it's a pump. They use the pump to pump the limestone powder out of the tankers, right? Well, the pump has a cap on it. The pump was capped off because they're not using it. It hooks to like a fire hose style thing that goes into the back. Well, the installer, who wasn't one of ours, started the truck, engaged the PTO, started testing. Pump was capped. Pump's building pressure. Blew the cap off. Went through the ceiling of the garage. Went through the roof of the garage. Pump was worthless, had to go in and get all new machine work, new casing, all that. It was about $3,000 worth of work on the PTO, plus the downtime on the truck, which, by the way, was loaded. So they had to take the trailer off and hook it to another tractor, which you're not supposed to do when the trailer is loaded because it's over the poundage of the whatever holds the trailer up. Okay, and that company had to pay to fix the roof and the ceiling. And if anybody would have been working upstairs or a mechanic would have even been leaning over the pump or somebody's arm would have been there, you'd be looking at hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of issues, right? So whenever you have PTO, please ask the customer or a mechanic to engage it first to make sure. Now, we engaged the PTO over at SRS. We were doing Descartes, Tazelle. I've been in that truck before. I've engaged that PTO before, okay? If you have a manual transmission vehicle in a PTO, you have to treat the PTO like a gear. Clutch in, PTO on, clutch out, okay? Can you both drive manual transmissions? Excellent. No, you don't drive manual? Okay, you should probably learn if you hear grinding when you engage the PTO, shut it down. Because that's what happens if you don't have the clutch pushed. Okay? Let's see. Can you hear from the area? Cable time three. We talked a little bit about trash management this week. Don't throw your trash on the ground. Because the owner of the company is going to walk by and see you throwing trash on the ground, and he's not going to walk by again when you're picking it up. You know what I mean? Well, if we go to the roofing yard and see cable ties on the ground, is that from the roofing supply company or is that from us? You know, our debris is unique. So it's not easily hideable. Red chunk of wire, that's us. White chunk of wire, that's us. Black chunk of wire, that's us. Copper, that's us. Clutter ring terminal, that's us. Empty tamper seal tube, that's us. You know, our debris is very unique, so we need to watch our garbage management. I prefer to use two separate bags. And you didn't see it this week. My second bag is full of other things, but I have a very large bag that's just empty. It has a shoulder strap. Garbage bag. Sometimes I put my little bag inside of it. I get there, I pull my bag out, I work the tools out of my trash bag, throw the trash in it, tools back on top, strap up, go with your stuff. Also, great practice is pop up laundry bins or pop up garbage bags. You can buy them on Amazon for about $12-$13. It works very well. Very well. Okay. Everything else in here I can do off the top of my head. Let's talk about true ignition for a minute. We talked about this week. We did some installs and we ran some tests, so some of this should be pretty general knowledge. But I'm going to draw out a, I don't know why that doesn't bother me so much. Let me draw it out over here. I'm going to draw the grid for true ignition. We're going to talk about why true ignition is so important. Part of the understanding of true ignition is ultimately going to be the understanding of the term debounce. Okay? So, you've heard the term debounce before.
I've heard it, but I just never knew what it meant.
Okay. Debounce is the time between successive triggers. So, if you walk up to me, here's the best example I've ever thought of in this training class, doorbell. You hit the thing, it goes ding dong, ding dong, ding dong, ding dong, right? If I hit it again,
I'm going to hear that sequence. Does it start over?
Yes. Does it? Depends on the doorbell. Most of them know. Because you start that sequence. So your debounce would be the time between the first press and the next allowable press. Let's see what I'm saying? If it's one that starts over any time you press it, then your debounce is zero. With me, David?
No.
Okay.
I understand what you said. All that.
Well, let me think of another way you can explain it.
If I have a zero debounce on a device, that means every time I touch this wire,
if it's a negative, every time I touch this wire, ground negative input. So if I go, I get five triggers.
Right.
If I have a 1 second debounce and I go, I get zero triggers, or just the first trigger, depending on how it's programmed.
If I have a 30-second debounce, okay, and I do that, anything I do again for the next 30 seconds isn't going to count until that 30 seconds elapses and it's ready for another trigger. That's
how debounce goes.
No, I don't want to use that verbiage. I want to use position one. Position two, and position three. Okay, so there's your five positions of a general key switch. Okay, for this example, we won't be using push button start technology. Although once you understand this, you can understand that. Okay, not that you don't understand it now. I may or may not give you some additional understanding through this exercise. Okay,
so you have five key positions,
right? Key out, key in, position one, which is accessory, position two, which is ignition, and position three, which is crank or start. Okay, any debate there? Okay.
So we have
wire number one, wire number two, wire number 3, wire number 4. Yeah.
We'll go with 4 wires.
Okay.
Oh, wait.
Yep, okay.
So,
these wires that we're looking for over here, I would like to identify them. Let's do this as 12-volt DC positive. Okay. Now, during the week, we've had some conversations regarding polarity, voltages, and inputs and outputs. In our field, it's important that you understand multiple characteristics of the wire and be able to speak in terms of talking about it and what that wire is going to do. Some basic characteristics that you want to know about any wire that you're either testing or working with. What voltage is it? Okay. Typically, the majority of the wires we're going to be working with are going to be DC, which stands for what? Direct current, that's right. What's our other option? Excellent. AC or DC, right? If this example, right now, we're going to stay in the DC realm. But when you're explaining to somebody what a wire is or what it's doing or how it's behaving, make sure we have voltage, AC or DC, and the polarity. And if possible, input or output. Okay? Now, when you have an output, you also need to know its current capability. Because just something could have a negative on it, but once you ground something to it, it goes away. Or if it has a positive there, it's enough to drive an LED, not enough to drive a relay, which is what we had happen with the perf switch setup out at SourceSync FNC rollout. Some of you guys heard me troubleshooting that setup and drawing a relay diagram and whatnot. Okay. A lot of times you're going to hear me ask about polarity. What are your two options? Check. Okay. So we have a 12-volt DC battery wire. We have an accessory wire. We have an ignition wire. And we have a starter wire. Okay? What are some wires that I haven't accounted for that are commonly found within a key cylinder? Key sensing. Okay, excellent. We'll add that one here. Okay, what else? One more. Blackout.
Second accessory,
second starter, second ignition, second constant, third ignition, third accessory, third starter, third constant. Yes. Okay.
So we just are acknowledging that those are possible.
Okay, in this example, I'm not going to go into the redundancies of seconds, although some second ignitions behave differently than first ignitions, but they're still called ignitions. Okay,
so what we're going to put in here in these squares, this is my Punnett square of ignition and accessory, or ignition cylinder Punnett square, if you will. We're going to determine the polarity of each of these wires in each of these states.
Okay, we're going to take turns. The battery wire at the key cylinder with no key in cylinder should be what polarity?
Positive.
Okay, what did you say, Diego? Why did you say negative?
That's a battery that's a wire that runs directly to the positive side of the battery.
That's an example, but it's negative, sorry.
It said the battery positive was negative. Okay. We should stop using both
doctor. No, on the first one that I used to give that direct tech.
All right, so we're going back and forth. So, okay. So Diego, if I put the key in the key cylinder, what should the battery wire be? Why? What is this wire? What does it say it is?
Positive.
It says right here.
It would be positive, sorry.
Okay. If I turn the key to the accessory position, what polarity is the battery wire? No.
Put it in the accessory position?
Uh-huh. Okay. Diego, if I put it in the ignition position, what polarity will the wire be?
Positive.
Okay. And lastly, Tizelle, cranking. Okay, next wire we're going to work with is the accessory wire. Okay? Okay, so do you, what polarity the accessory wire with no key in the key cylinder? Don't know. There's two options, actually.
Yeah, but
it's either one random or all. Well, there's actually three answers to these questions. Zero, negative, positive. You can have no polarity. You can be just an open wire.
That accessory zero.
It could be zero, or it could be negative. Depends on the car. Giselle, key in.
Same thing, zero and negative.
Okay. Diego, in the accessory position, what polarity is the accessory wire?
Same.
No, sir. Giselle.
Positive.
Positive, correct. Diego, in the ignition position, what polarity is the accessory wire?
Positive.
Okay. And Giselle, in the crank position?
Crank position. Accessory is
negative. It's zero or negative. Depends on the car. The ignition wire, no key in the cylinder. Diego.
Zero or negative.
Correct. Key in the cylinder.
Zero or negative.
Zero or negative. Okay. Accessory position. Diego.
Positive.
Oh,
accessory, no. Zero or negative.
Okay, correct. Zero or negative. Ignition position.
Positive.
Crank position. Diego.
Zero or negative.
Giselle.
Positive.
Ignition is a term
that used to mean a lot more than it does now.
Okay. Let's take ourselves back to cars, carburetors, and distributors. Have you worked on one?
No, we're not.
Okay. Neither one of you. Okay, cool. So we're going to learn a little something about old school cars right now. Okay. You got your distributor, right? Okay, right? Inside the distributor, you got this thing called a cap and a rotor. And it spins around. In fact, I should show it this way. So you got all these studs inside. You got this arm that spins around. And it spins around. It goes tick, 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 and it sends all the spark down the different spark plug wire. If you get a really fancy one, it sends a vacuum and motor, and it twists it just a little bit for the advance. Anyway, it gets right out. Anyway, so you got that right. And then in the center post, feeding a conductor on top of the cap and rotor here. Is a wire that goes to something that typically looks like this. Okay. Anybody ever seen one of these?
A solenoid, isn't it?
Coil. This is what's responsible. And typically, you will have one side to chassis, whether you want to make a chassis like that, or if you are with these guys for chassis, however you do your schematics. Okay, and the other side, okay, this is what polarity over here.
Negative.
Okay, and the other side goes to ignition. And this is positive, and this is the actual ignition coil that transforms. It's a transformer, essentially, that takes 12-volt DC in and sends 20,000-volt DC out. Or more, 30, 40, 50 is a higher voltage, the better off you are, but you're going to get thirsty on the amperage side, and then there's some Ohm's law involved there. Ohm's law, what's the, how do you remember it?
How do I remember Ohm's law?
Yeah. Diego? Tire. T. I over R. E. Tire. Ohm's law, right there. Boom. You get every formula you could possibly need right off that. Everybody know what the L stands for?
Current, resistance, and
voltage. I don't know why it's got a V, but it's tire. Okay. That's Ohm's law. Okay, so we have 12 volt DC positive coming in off of the key switch. So if you do not turn on the ignition wire, you do not turn on the ignition coil, you do not have voltage to send down your wires, therefore you have the spark at the spark plug, which would be the ignition, which is igniting the fuel within the cylinder, which is what is B being the power stroke and the force stroke and forcing the piston connected to the rod and cranked up, so producing torque on the spark. So, this is where the action comes. Now, this is also why, because inside this coil is legitimately a coil, all right? And one side hits the ground. If I don't have anything connected over here, what polarity is going to be present right here?
Zero or
negative? Negative. Because that negative is going to be residual to the coil, just like if you use a relay, okay? And I have ground here. What polarity is going to be here?
Positive to
activate. But if I just ground one side and meter this, what am I going to have? Negative. Because inside here is a coil. See what's going on? That's why old school ignition wires left at negative. And new school parts don't go to the ignition coil. In between here, you got a PCM, you got a relay, and you got push to start. In the old days, all the amperage to run this coil would be switched through the key, which is why the wire is so thick and the key's so thick. Okay, the cost of copper made it so that you can't do this anymore. We're sick of all these switches failing because they're high amperage. And we all go put a hot coil on your car and not bring on your ignition switch. Happened all the time. So they got BTMs and relays and all this other stuff that isolate the coil. Plus, on new cars, you might have 8 coils. You know, your car has 3 coils that are dual terminal. That's called DIS. Distributorless ignition system, but you also are using waste spark, which is a 3-channel ignition system for 6 cylinders, which means you are sparking your spark plugs and your wires and your coils 2 times per every revolution, and you only need to do it once, but you would need a 6-channel system to do that. Okay? So they are purposely building in burning out spark plugs and wires so that we have to keep buying them. Okay? Now you start to learn a little something about fuel economy and built-in replacements and stuff like that. So ultimately, what this has come down to is the reason that the ignition wire is negative or zero, in an older car, it's negative. In a newer car, it's probably zero. Because if it's on a PCM, it's pulled the other direction. Now, you might have a residual. Does everyone know about high and low in circuits? If I have a negative input coming into a circuit, I want a negative input to trigger something. What polarity do I want the circuit board to rest at while waiting for negative? Low is negative. I'm going to want to rest high, which would be positive. So if you ever test, like if you have a negative input on a GPS and you test it with your power probe, you're going to see a faint positive, because it rests the other direction. So when the negative comes in, it pulls it to be switched, electrically pulls it, okay? We're getting really deep into some board theory here. We start talking about NPN and PNP and transistors and all types of cool stuff I could talk about all day, but really not what we're here for, okay? Marcus, the video's down. So that's where the zero negative comes in, because it depends on what kind of car you're working with as to how that's going to pan. Oh, it might be because my tablet died. So, starter wire with no key in the cylinder, what is it going to be? Let's go with you. Zero or negative, okay? My tablet might have died if that had something to do with it. Okay. With the key in on the starter wire, what are we going to have?
Zero or negative.
Zero or negative, correct. And the reason the starter wire is zero or negative, because it may or may not be attached to a relay, right? Starter trigger, where starter wire could be this wire in a relay that's grounded on the other side, and this is the output to the starter, right? Does everybody know their relays by these diagrams? Not yet, but you're working on it. Yeah, my relay class is a whole nother day, dude. So the accessory wire, in the accessory position, the starter wire, Diego. Is your starter on when your key is an accessory?
Yeah.
There you go. Giselle. Ignition position, starter wire. Zero or negative. All right, Diego. Aha. All right. What wire is this? Key sense. Now, what I didn't tell you is what polarity key sense we're looking for, because key sense can be positive or negative polarity. Marcus, positive or negative? Just pick one. Okay, so in this example, we're going to use the negative key sense, okay? And that's actually a good call, Marcus, because that's going to expose something we haven't seen yet on this chart, and that's a little tip if you guys are following at home. You can take a picture of this chart if you want it when we're done.
Okay?
This is also a chart very similar to this, just not as in-depth, is available in a NavMan cube manual. You can see it in there, okay? So a negative key sense with no key in the cylinder is going to rest at what polarity? Either one of you. Okay, positive or open. So now we get our first positive or zero, right? Okay, key, with the key in, what's a negative key sense going to read? Diego. Do you know what a key, you know what a key sense wire is?
No.
It senses if the key is there. And when the key is there, it's going to send a negative. So what is it going to be when the key is there? When the key is there, it's going to send a negative. What's it going to send when the key is in? No, it's going to send negative. That's the trigger. It's a wire that turns negative when the key goes in the cylinder.
To repeat that, when the key's out, it's going to be positive.
Positive
or zero. And mm-hmm. when the key's in, that it senses the key, it's going to be a negative.
Yeah.
And it's laying on negative, right?
With the key in. Not with the key out. The key out is positive zero.
Oh, okay. Okay.
See? I flipped it there. Good job, Marcus. I mean, on the next one, on the fan. So in the accessory position, what's the key sense going to read? Okay. In the ignition position, what's the key sense going to read? In the crank position, what's the key sense going to read? Right. Now, I'm going to fill out the bottom, and I want you to tell me. See, I got a question mark over there. I want you to tell me what wire this is, okay? All right. Okay. Well, why is that?
Second ignition.
Yeah. Now this is present. In Sterling's.
Okay. This is present.
In some Chevy vans. And
sometimes the fuse box wires in multiple units.
They test only positive in ignition, but when you go to crank it, it goes to zero. This is a wire you want to avoid when connecting a telematics device. Now, if we're connecting an accessory device like a backup camera, this is a great wire to use. Who can tell me? Mm-hmm.
Everybody's going to go ahead and activate it the vehicle's already on.
It'll
activate the vehicle's on. That's one of the traits of
this wire. What's
something this wire has a
unique trait versus a true ignition? And
I would like to say the terminology true ignition solely defines the behavior of this wire. True ignition must remain positive during crank. Because in our old school car scenario, if this wire dropped out during crank, would the car ever start?
Why?
Because the coil needs positive to fire the ignition system.
It is ignition by definition. Okay? So,
we have... When you monitor the voltage of a vehicle during crank, what kind of voltages do you see?
In crank, you're asking for a specific voltage?
Sure. What's the voltage that you've seen on a wire that during crank?
During during crank, either 12, anywhere between 12 to 14, 14.
So if the battery is 12 when I get there, and I introduce a 100 amp load from a starter, you're telling me it's still 12.
No, it goes up 13, 14.
It goes up. So while I'm starting my car, my battery is gaining power?
No, it drops.
Okay.
Does it go up? Or does it drop?
No, it drops. It's 9-7 volts because you're using voltage to go ahead and start it. So the battery right. drops and it picks up because of the alternator.
Technically, we're using amperes to start it as well as voltage. Just want to make sure. I mean, really, you can say we're using wattage. But when you induce a load like that into a battery, the voltage goes down. Okay? And you're putting an extreme load on it. So the reason that this ignition tube is such a great wire to use when you're wiring an accessory like a backup camera is because that voltage drop during crank, it does not make the device susceptible to that abuse. But it also doesn't come on when you're an accessory. Which means the guy just sitting there listening to the radio, backup camera's not on the truck. Right? Now, let's talk quickly about what happens to amperage when voltage goes down. Let me know when you guys have done this note. I'm going to draw one more mystery wire on here. All right. Okay, don't use your wire just yet, okay? Or should we do that first? Yeah, let's do the mystery wire first. Our terminal.
Anybody ever heard that terminology before?
Terminal. Okay, so an R terminal is a terminal that's present mainly on alternators of heavy-duty equipment and or heavy-duty vehicles. The R terminal is goes positive only when the alternator is spinning and producing voltage, which means even in the crank position, it is not producing voltage. This is the truest and purest engine monitoring trigger you can achieve. If you want to know how many hours that engine is running, this is your golden goose as far as the reporting wire. Okay? If you're doing
heavy equipment and the guy says, this is out in the sand pit and I need to know the hours.
A lot of times, even an hour's gauge in the vehicle is not going to be our thermal. But when you start getting into cases, Caterpillars, and John Deere, things like that, this our thermal is very prominent. Also, sometimes.
How often do we run out specifically to the R terminal?
Not very.
But it is there and it does exist.
And I want to make sure you guys were aware. I learned
about it after, you know, working here for a while.
I didn't know. Okay.
Anybody want a picture of this before we bring it up?
And the R terminal tells you the hours of running time?
The R terminal only tells you that the engine is running. It
actually doesn't even tell you that it's running. It tells you that the alternator is spinning,
which would be very difficult to do without the engine running. Thank you. Okay. At some point, throw that up in the TikTok.
Yes. Just throw the pictures up. Don't say anything. It's supposed to be.
Drop a mic.
Okay.
Be like,
all right. Any other questions on this before I get into
map voltage theory? Okay.
So, during cranking of the vehicle, it has been established that the voltage drops on the batteries, correct?
And during that voltage drop, an issue in discussion, we can get rid of that. Did a roll take like we get rid of that. We haven't talked about tamper seal yet, and we still have to talk about projects. Okay, so we're gonna do amperage voltage, then tamper seal, then projects, then and for questions, then we're gonna go in the shop and look at a few different products that we haven't seen yet, and then I think we're gonna do today. Okay? Then I'm
going to very graciously ask
Diego to drop you off at the other hotel on his way out of town. It's going to fly.
No, I just laughed. Oh, well, all
right. It's not that far away. This
side of the board is very
close over here. And we want to talk about tamper seal and projects. There we go. Okay, so during that voltage drop, V is typically the sign for voltage, A is typically the sign for amperage, okay, and W is the sign for? Correct. If I want to determine how many amps a circuit is going to require when I have 3,000 watts, and vehicle is running at 14 volts, how many amps do I have? Anybody know how to do this formula?
No.
Take your wattage, divide it by your voltage, equals your amperage. Because really, you do this. That's the full formula, okay?
There's some efficiencies in there. You know, if this was a 94% efficient inverter, it would actually be 3,200 and some kind of what I mean. You know, this isn't a perfect, but this is the standard formula.
Okay. So,
everything ends up taking wattage at some point. So, let's say the wattage rating, and we don't really speak in wattage much unless we're working with power inverters.
Okay.
But I'm going to speak in wattage right now because I want to wrap your mind around the fact that voltage and amperage are not independent entities. They are directly related to the function of power by the transistor. Who can tell me what a transistor is?
A transistor. I'll name one.
Speaker.
What is
it?
A transducer. What's a transducer? A transducer is a device or system that converts energy from one form to another, whether it's AC current into audio frequency, such as a speaker does, audible noise, whether it's wattage to mechanical force, like a starter or an electric motor, okay? Transducer can be a water wheel that converts it to, you know, hydroelectric power as a transducer. This fan right here, transducer, as it is converting 120 volt 60 hertz AC signal at certain low amperage to mechanical force, which is the electric motor, which is then converting it to airflow. So there's actually two or three transducers at work right here. Okay? Just like the camera is a transducer, it's taking light energy and it's converting it to digital data and storing it on a solid state card. These are all transducers. Think of it as a converter, okay? And the reason that I get into some of these definitions is to make sure that you're looking at things as building blocks of a larger system and not getting hung up on specific inputs and outputs and limitations, okay? You've noticed, but I try and teach a very open-minded type of class when it comes to relays and coils and diodes and all these different things that you're going to see, okay? So there is a wattage associated, okay? So let's say the wattage on your starter motor is oh, well, the starter motor typically draws around 100 amps at 12, 14 volts. So we call it 1,200. Because 12 times 100 would be 1,200 watts. Okay, so let's say your starter motor is 1,200 watts. Okay? Those are horrible zeros. So I'm going to recreate those in a much neater manner. Okay? So,
this is our formula. Okay? If your batteries are healthy
and they
can stay at 12 volts,
how many amps
does it take to run the starter motor at 1,200 watts?
100. Excellent.
100.
Okay?
When your battery drops down to 9 volts, how many amps does it take
to run your starter motor at 1,200 watts? Feel free to use a calculator. Calculator on the homepage.
133.33, and you put a line over it.
I said over and
under it. Somebody was watching this at the math, but just
to kill me for question that. It's over it. We're repeating infinitely, correct?
Yes.
So, what have we learned here about the relationship between voltage and amperage? You know what?
We need one more piece of the puzzle.
Let's say that you are running a red Chevy Blazer in a competition car on your setup, and you have a 16-volt setup in there. Okay? Let's say your battery is 16 volts. Okay?
At 16 volts,
how many amps do we need to produce our 1,200 watts from the starter?
75.
Okay. So what do we think about our relationship between amperage and voltage?
You need very little amperage.
The higher the voltage, the lower the amperage.
Nah, that's one.
Okay, so you said higher voltage,
lower amperage.
Higher V equals lower A, right? Okay. What about inversely? What is a
lower V equals question mark A? Solve for question mark.
Lower voltage.
Right. So
as voltage decreases, amperage increases. A horrible arrow. Hope you know what I mean by that.
Okay? So
when we have a device like a backup
camera, okay, or
some smart lighting device, let's say,
and it is connected to that ignition 2 wire that drops out there cranking, okay, it does not allow the device to fight for amperage.
See, as the starter motor engages, the amperage of the starter motor goes up.
It's a kind of a line and all this curvature math and everything. I'm not going to get into the real formulas involved with calculating real time and the telescope based current flow and all that. We're not going to get into that today. But if I have a device connected to that, and let's reset some of the numbers here, okay? Let's say we're working with a device with a 10 amp fuse on it, okay? So it's a 10 amp fuse, and it's made to work at 12 volts. Okay,
so how many watts is that device?
120 watts. Okay. As the
starter motor engages and lowers the vehicle voltage, sometime all the way to 7.
Okay. How many amps do you need to still pull that 120 watts? It's 7 volts.
17.14.
17.
Okay. So we've almost doubled the current draw. Remember, amperage
current? We've almost doubled the current draw of this device by
allowing it to be affected during the crank cycle, which is sometimes why when we're not dealing with a telematics device or a GPS device that wants true ignition,
why is best not hooked to a wire that's positive during crank? Because if it's a sensitive electronic, like a DVR system, we don't want a DVR system every time the bus comes on to peak draw 17 amps, and this may be below its reboot threshold. This can sometimes cause issues internally on the board and just overall with an electrical punishment to the device to deal with this type of draw. Now, if it goes from 12 to 11, you know, we did it out of 11. We're all waiting for
10.90.
So less than a 10% increase in amperage. Right? Plus, don't forget, the fuse is rated at 10 amps. It doesn't mean the device draws 10 amps.
Right.
Okay? Fuses typically don't blow until the device their actual rated number. It also depends on the temperature and construction and all kinds of other things. For the purpose of understanding the relationship between voltage and amperage, we're going to assume that's the same. Okay? In order to really just keep this short, we can't allow all possible variations and facts. We have to, I don't say facts to be here, but this is the general concept. Okay? So that's why sometimes with delicate accessories, we will use an accessory wire or an ignition 2 that behaves like a real ignition 2, not a second ignition, an ignition 2. Okay?
Wire that maybe doesn't have
any freight line stories, but a handful of wires labeled as second ignition on there, and they
all drop off during crank. Okay, speaking of freight liners, never go to the key cylinder on a freight liner Cascadia. Freight liner Cascadia, never go to the key cylinder. It will know you're there and it will cause issues with the trucks. They're easy trucks to do. Don't let that scare you. But that's not a great place to be.
I just know it's Cascadia. Right?
Hmm?
Cascadia.
Any questions about the relationship between voltage and amperage?
No.
Okay. I don't know what happened there.
Neither do I.
No, it says I don't even have anything connected, so I know I'm dead here. Yeah, you did. Although I don't know why I'm dead when I have a charge port and a remote charger right next to it.
That's weird. It froze on my other wheel. And it probably dropped. All right,
well, I'm really close to done in here, so.
Okay, so
if you want to let it roll, let it roll.
Well, I mean, there's going to be more.
Not at all?
No.